Hi guys, Brian from Brian Boas here. Breeding their pet boa constrictors is the ultimate goal for many boa keepers. However, there are some very common mistakes that people frequently make that will reduce their odds of success in this area. Today I'm going to go over some of these mistakes and advise you how you can avoid them. So if you aspire to breed your boas, pay attention, and hopefully these tips will improve your odds of success. If you're new to the channel, this is the place for information about all aspects of keeping and breeding boa constrictors in captivity. So if you want to learn all about these amazing animals, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on any of my future boa videos. The first mistake that aspiring boa breeders make is getting into this mentality of, I want to be a breeder, as soon as they enter the hobby. So these people have just got their first boa, they've had it for 3 weeks, and they're already planning what pairings they're going to make and what breeding they're going to do in the future. So when you first enter the hobby, you really should be focused on learning as much as you can about boas. Understand their husbandry, understand their genetics, understand different localities, different morphs, things like that. And make sure you have the husbandry completely down pat before you think about breeding. So in the past, there was a lot of emphasis on breeding reptiles in general because there wasn't as much of a supply. But with the large supply of many types of reptiles, including many boas that are currently available, people should really think twice before breeding. Breeding isn't for everyone, and it's not something you should enter into lightly. So my advice for you if you're new to boas would be to enjoy your boa, learn as much as you can about it. If you 6 months or a year down the road, you decide to get another one, that's fine, but just continue to learn. And so that if a few years down the road, you're still interested in possibly breeding, you can make plans at that point. But don't get ahead of yourself and make sure that you really understand the basic biology of boas before deciding to breed. The second mistake for aspiring breeders is not understanding boa genetics. And this is especially true if you're a morph breeder. And I'm often dumbstruck by some of the questions I see on Facebook where people are claiming to be breeding boas and they don't have the most basic understanding of genetics, like what a dominant versus recessive gene is, what an incomplete dominant gene is. So you really need to understand this. And there are many good tutorials and YouTube videos out there. I intend to release a video in the future on boa genetics. But you should understand how to predict the outcomes of a simple single gene dominant recessive cross by making a Punnett square, for example. In addition, there are a lot of good genetics calculators like on morphmarket.com where you can just put in the genotypes of your animals and you can figure out what the potential offspring are going to be. You also need some awareness of what types of genes are incompatible. For example, there are a number of different types of albinos. There's the Kahl albino, there's the Sharp albino, and then there are the T-positive albinos, and they're all not compatible with each other. So if you have a male that's the Kahl albino and a female that's the Sharp albino, and you cross them, you're not going to get any albinos. They're all going to be het for both Kahl and Sharp. So make sure that you understand the genetic basis of the genes that you're getting into. The third mistake is attempting to breed before you've mastered basic boa husbandry. So you want to have a complete understanding of the proper environment for your boas, and you want to make sure that you can provide this 100% of the time. If your boas aren't kept to the highest standard of husbandry, you shouldn't be attempting to breed them. The fourth breeding mistake is not focusing enough. And as you know, there's a huge diversity of different boas out there between the different locality and different morph boas. There are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of different possibilities. And so nobody can do it all, so you really need to focus. So if you're into locality boas, you might want to focus on a niche within locality boas, like Mexican boas, such as this Tarahumara mountain boa, dwarf boas, which include some of the island boas, as well as this Tarahumara boa, true red tails, for example. Or if you're getting into morphs, you might want to focus on just a few genes, for example, IMG jungle VPI combos. But don't try to do too much. Don't try to do it all. If you end up not focusing, you're going to have a lot of animals that you can't really breed with each other because they're from a different locality or they're containing different genes, things like that. And you want to maximize the potential of the breeding within your breeding colony. When you're first getting into boas, there's no way you can have the experience to really determine what you want to focus on, which is another reason why you should wait for a few years before you decide to breed. And at that point, you can focus on setting up a top-notch breeding group of whatever specialty within boas you decide to focus on. The fifth mistake is related to not focusing, and that's overexpanding, where you try to accommodate too many boas into too many projects than you have the bandwidth to support. So when you get boas, they're these cute little babies, but of course they grow, they take more space, they take more time to take care of, they take more food and other resources. So you want to be sure that as your breeding group is growing, that you're not overexpanding beyond your eventual capacity. And in addition, as you get successful breeding, you'll have some holdbacks and you'll want to raise those up. So, you know, breeding projects can quickly expand in the number of animals that you're going to have, and you want to make sure not to expand beyond what you're capable of handling resource-wise. Mistake number six is one I see often among people that are new to the hobby that ignore my first advice about not trying to breed too quickly, and that's trying to acquire a lot of females. And they have this idea that you can have just a few male boas, and you can have huge numbers of females, and you'll just take a male and you'll rotate him between a bunch of different females, and he'll pump out litter after litter, you know, like the stud boa he is, and you'll end up getting numerous litters from the same male every year. People may be able to use an approach like this with ball pythons and some other reptiles, but with boas, you really need a relatively high male to female ratio. So you pretty much want to have at least one male for every two females. That would be the absolute minimum, up to probably one male to every one female. And I typically shoot for about 1.5 males for every two females. So basically I have a few more females than males. And my rationale is that my males can potentially breed every year. The females will breed every other year. So in theory, having twice as many females would work with the, you know, that number of males. But in practice, some males are just really not very good breeders, and you want to give them a year off in between for some of them. In addition, you may want to use multiple males to increase the odds of success. So you want to put two males in with one female. So for that reason, you definitely don't want to skimp on buying males, and buy a lot of really high quality males for your breeding group. People will often try to get all the females, and it, you know, something that kind of irks me as a breeder. They just want to buy females, you know, with the idea that I talked about. But really, you should be buying both males and females for the success of your breeding group. The next breeding mistake, number six, is using potential future profits from your breeding to justify your current expenditure. So someone might do this calculation on paper, and they might predict that, you know, 5 years from now, if everything works perfectly, I could potentially have $20,000 a year of babies or something like that. So then they go out and they buy lots of expensive equipment and expensive breeders with this idea that it's going to be a sure thing. But of course, boa breeding is by far not a sure thing. So you really need to not approach it with that kind of mentality, and go in because you love the boas, you love the potential for breeding them. It's not about the money. You know, as I've said in many of my previous videos, if you enter boa breeding with this idea that, you know, the primary reason is for money, you're almost positively not going to be successful. Very few people actually make money breeding boas, and it's those who stick with it for a very long time, or those who just happen to be in a very hot moor for a very expensive project that's successful. So don't enter it as an investment. You know, if you want a better investment, put your money in the stock market. So I miscounted. That was actually the seventh mistake not to make. So mistake number eight is related, and that's getting into a breeding project because you think you can make money doing it. You might pick a very expensive or hot new morph that's, you know, hot right now, and you're sure that you're going to make money doing this. And so if you don't absolutely love the morph or the locality, you really shouldn't be breeding it. Stick to the boas you really love, because that way, if you can't find homes for them, you're happy just keeping them. If you enter these hot new projects, especially certain morphs, they can crash in price really fast. So by the time you get around to being successful breeding them, the price might have bottomed out and you might be lucky just to get the return of your initial investment. So only breed what you love and boas that you would be happy to just keep for yourself. Mistake number 9 is being too picky on your breeding stock. And I know we all want the best possible breeding stock, and you should definitely seek out high quality breeding stock, but there are some people that just have these ridiculous expectations for what their boas are going to look like, and they're based on photos they've seen online that are really skillfully done, and they really show off the boa to its full, you know, its best advantage. There's also this misconception that the quality of boas, even within a single litter, can vary greatly. And you see, I've seen people who price their litters of boas. In some cases, there's like a tenfold difference between what they consider the lowest quality and the highest quality. But I look at the boas and I really can't see this difference. You know, in honesty, based on my experience with my litters, yes, there are a few that stand out. But most of the boas are all really nice. So even if you get a boa that's not the pick of the litter, or you know, one of the best out of the litter, you're still potentially going to get a really nice boa. And there's not this secret club of boa breeders that takes control of all these really top-notch boas, and you know, people that aren't in this club can't get them. The truth is, there's a lot of really nice boas out there. When I set up my breeding group, I didn't have any special connections or anything like that. I just bought boas that looked really nice and that there was a good reputation for the seller, and I've been really happy. With some types of locality boas, they're also extremely hard to get, and there's very few breeders, so you really can't pass up the potential to buy some boa. So if you have a project in mind and you're lucky that the locality, there's a litter that becomes available, you want to snap on them as quickly as possible. Don't delay, because these boas can sell out really quick, sometimes in a matter of hours from going on sale. Once the babies are sold, it might be a long time before another litter is available. And I've seen several people that have reached out to me with a boa that's up for sale, and they say, well, I kind of like it, but I'm not 100% convinced. And I'm like, well, it looks nice to me, but then they don't jump on it and they miss out, and then they can't get that type of boa. So don't be overly picky when selecting your breeders. Mistake number 10 is a common reason why people fail at breeding, and that's not being patient and trying to breed animals when they're too young. So as I mentioned before many times, in general, most locality boas, the females should be a full 5 years old, the males a full 4 years old before you pair them up. And morph boas generally can breed a year or two younger, but you definitely don't want to rush them, because boas take quite a while to reach breeding size. You definitely don't want to power feed or overfeed your boa in an attempt to get it to breeding size too quickly, because it's going to have a much higher fat content and it's going to be much less muscular and much less able to successfully breed. The best breeders have a really fit, muscular appearance. They're not too skinny, but they're definitely not fat either. This is my female Anerythristic Peregrinera Peninsula boa, and she's now almost 5 years old. She'll be 5 years old in a couple months. So some people might have bred her last year, or actually this year, you know, right now, but I would prefer to wait. And so she's going to be ready to breed next year, where, you know, going into the breeding, she'll be about 5.5 years old. You know, and sometimes when you wait a little longer, the boas get to be in better shape and they get to be a little bit bigger, and you're more likely to get a nice full litter and to have breeding success, rather than if you push a female to breed at too young of an age. Mistake number 11 is obsessing about the optimal cycling conditions for your boa and attributing your lack of success to just needing to tweak the cycling. So the truth is, there are many different cycling regimens that will work for breeding boas. Some people cool them and stop feeding for about 2 months. Some people cool them for shorter periods during the winter fasting. Some people don't cool them at all. I think there's even some morph breeders that don't even do the winter fasting. They just feed their boas year-round and they don't do cooling. And boas have been successful breeding under all these conditions. Of course, for some locality boas, you know, different cycling will work better. So I'm not saying do not cycle or do not try to get a cycling that works, but just don't obsess about that's the one thing that you need to nail down to have your boas breed, because breeding boas is not a recipe. It's not like breeding other types of reptiles. There's an art to it. There's being able to read the animals and to adjust to their needs to get them to make babies. And that's really the art of boa breeding. Breeding mistake number 12 is giving up too quickly. The truth is that many boa breeding projects are not going to be successful the first time around. You may have to repair the animals the following year and hope for results. Or you may have to try different pairings or somehow tweak your breeding a little bit based on what you learned the previous year. You know, I've been doing this a while. Every year I get a little bit better. I learn a little bit more. But, you know, it's this constant learning that really keeps me interested in the challenges of breeding these beautiful constrictors. Breeding mistake number 13 is separating the male and the female too soon. So some people will put their male in with the female, they see the male going after the female, courting her, and they see the tails wrapped up and they think, you know, they've done the deed and the babies are on the way. But the truth is that this is just probably courtship. It can take many months of courtship before the male mates with the female. So my boas in general are together for anywhere from 4 to 6 months. I pair them up in late December and then they stay together for close to 2 months. Then I start to separate them, feed them, keep them separate for a week, and then I put them back together for about a month. And I repeat this process until, in some cases, June. So it's 4 to 6 months of being together, which hopefully will lead to successful fertilization and a successful litter. Often when people separate the animals too soon and don't keep them together long enough, they end up with a litter of slugs or otherwise are not successful in breeding. The next breeding mistake involves how you acquire your breeding stock. And the mistake is to try to acquire adult breeders that are already ready to breed rather than growing up your own babies. And so it might be tempting to try to look for adults and save at least a few years, if not up to 4 or 5 years, off of having to grow your own babies and get to the breeding size. However, there's a few issues to this approach. When you think about the time and energy it requires for somebody to grow up babies to breeding size, why would somebody go through all the years of this only to just sell their breeders right when they're ready to produce babies? So what it tells you is that there might be something wrong with these adult breeders and the person has tried to breed them before and for whatever reason been unsuccessful. Occasionally you can find people that have a change in circumstances and they just suddenly need to get out of boas, and sometimes you can get really good breeding stock this way, but this is really rare. So I would say that if you do see somebody that is selling adult breeders, you want to ask them why they're selling them and if there's any issues with them. You know, sometimes they just didn't breed for that particular person. There's still a chance they might breed in another circumstance, such as at your facility. But really, the best way to produce healthy breeders is to acquire healthy babies and then to grow them up slowly over a 4 to 5 year period. These babies will be attuned to the conditions at your particular facility and represent the best possible chances of breeding success. So another mistake involves specifically locality boas, and this is a very, very important part of locality boa breeding, and that is that you don't cross different localities with each other. So this is a big no-no if you have locality-specific boas. So there's a couple reasons why. So this will produce mixed offspring, which have really no value to the locality boa collector. You know, for example, if you cross a Suriname redtail boa with a Barranquilla Colombia boa, you might get some baby boas, but no one is really going to want these outside of his pets. So they're not really going to have any value to the locality collector. In addition, it makes it really confusing when people are trying to preserve pure locality breeding stock. And once you cross two localities, you can never go back to a pure locality. The line at that point cannot go back to the pure locality. And I see this a lot with Hog Island boas like this one. So unfortunately, a lot of people are crossing Hog Island boas with hypo common boas, and they get something called a hypo hog, and then sometimes they cross it back with more hypo and they get this thing called a sunset boa, which has these bright orange colors. So what's bad about this is often these hypo hogs look similar to hog island boas, and many newbies get them confused and they can't tell the difference between a pure hog island boa and one of these hypo hogs. So you definitely don't want to cross your hog island boas with non-hog island breeding stock. If you want to do something like this, there are a lot of morph boas that already are not locality specific. Most morph boas are mixed locality, so you don't really have to worry about the locality. But for locality specific boas, you never ever want to cross different localities. The next mistake applies to when you're successful breeding, and that is not keeping enough whole back animals. So after you've gone through all this effort to produce these beautiful babies, you're definitely going to want to save a few that represent the next generation of breeding, and you're going to want to select the characteristics that you're looking for in your particular breeding project. So early on, I didn't save enough whole backs. In some cases, I wish I had saved even more. In general, I would save, you know, maybe two or three animals, my favorites from each litter. You know, in some cases, I sold one or more of those, but in general, I wish I had saved a few more early on. You know, I'm really happy that I did save some really nice animals, which are now going into the second generation of breeding. But again, I stress, you really want to save animals, because once you sell an animal, it's usually not possible to get it back. So be absolutely sure the animals that are leaving your facility, you're ready to let go. Of course, you don't want to save everything, and you know, obviously you have limits in your resources, so there's only a certain number of holdbacks you can save. But I would definitely err on the side of holding back too many, because you can always sell them at 1 or 2 years old if you need to free up some space or other resources. The next mistake applies to pricing your boas, and that is improperly pricing your boas. And it's really a bad idea to price them either too high or too low. So you really want to have a good understanding of the current market price for your particular boa when you're setting your prices. And there's a lot of information on the online classifieds like kingsnake.com and Fauna Classifieds and Morph Market, where you can determine the current market prices. So both setting them too low and too high is a mistake. And when I first started and I didn't really know very many people, in some cases I set my boa prices a little too low. So you'd think, well, they would sell really quickly if you set them too low. But really, if the market price is below the market value, sometimes people think that there might be something wrong with your boas, or it's a little suspicious and they might not sell. And in fact, in some cases I had boas that didn't sell. And to solve this problem, I just added $100 to the asking price, and then they would sell. So you don't want to price too low. I've seen a lot of people lately, and I don't know if they're just shooting for the moon or something, but they have a asking price that's like 3 or 4 times what the current market price is. So there's no way that someone is going to pay these crazy high prices. Maybe they don't actually want to sell. But it's really not good to price your animals too high either. So the last mistake is a major reason why many people fail at breeding, and it's because breeding boas and being successful as a boa breeder has a lot more to do than just with making baby boas. There's a lot of other skills that you need to be successful. And so a mistake would be not getting competence in these skills as you're developing as a boa breeder. So when you're growing up your babies to breeding size, you want to build up strength and competence in these areas if you want to be successful as a boa breeder. So one very important thing is marketing. You need to let people know you're working on these projects and you have these boas and you're potentially going to have offspring a few years down the line. So you want to build up your connections on social media, and to let people show people what boas you have, give them updates as they're developing, and you know, with your upcoming breeding plans. You also want to learn about how to take pictures of boas so you can have really top-notch photographs that are going to show off your babies to prospective buyers. And then you're also going to want to develop competence in the other areas that are necessary, such as marketing boas, how to write ads on the online classifieds, as well as how to ship boas. You'll need to know the boa shipping so you can get your baby boas to their buyers throughout the country. And I actually did a video in the past on other skills that you'll need, so check out that video if you want to learn more about these other skills. So I hope this video was somewhat helpful and maybe it gave you some ideas about your boa breeding projects. As always, if you have any questions or comments, feel free to shoot me a line via social media. Thanks for watching and enjoy your boas.